Let us worship God together with our responsive call to worship. Why do you seek the living among the dead? Christ is not here. He is risen. How can this be? We saw him placed in the tomb. Remember what he told you, that on the third day he would rise again. Go now, run, tell the others what you have heard and seen. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Please be seated. In raising Jesus from the grave, God shattered the power of sin and death, as we just sang, and brought us life eternally. So how can we keep living as if we fear the shadows, as if the grave still terrifies us? How can we look away from the ones in need for whom Christ gave his life? Knowing the full extent of God's grace and love, how can we remain captive to doubt and fear? Let us boldly come before God with our prayer of confession, followed by a time of personal, silent confession. Let us pray together. Eternal God, we bow before your throne of grace, trusting that your capacity for mercy exceeds our capacity for sin, and that your long reach can find us no matter how far we run from you. We take comfort, O God, in the depth of love we have seen in Jesus Christ. For we know that in his love we have seen your love. We cannot explain why we turn away from you and why we think we can find more joy on the paths of our own choosing. But we are grateful that you come in search of us and in an act of suffering love, welcome us home. For this and for every expression of your faithfulness to us, O God, we lift our voices in thanksgiving and praise, and we commit ourselves anew to living as your faithful people through Jesus Christ, our Lord. As the angel told the women, "Don't be afraid, he has been raised. Indeed, Christ died for us, Christ rose for us, and reigns in power for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone, and a new life has begun. Know that you and I are forgiven, and be at peace."
Please be seated. In the name of the risen Christ, welcome to this time of worship as we gather here on Easter Sunday, the most significant day of the church year for us. We're glad you're here. Whether you're a member of the church or visiting with us, we're grateful for your presence and hope all of you will sign the friendship pads as they are passed back and forth along the pew. If you are in search of a church home, we'd be glad for you to think about making this that home for yourself as you join us and as we seek to be disciples of Jesus Christ in and for this community. Just a few announcements to make. We don't have a long, on the back of the bulletin, a long listing of things today, but I would remind you that we continue to receive and collect our FPC shares item. First Presbyterian Church shares our way of responding to some of the hunger needs in our community. The items we are collecting this month are canned spaghetti or canned ravioli, something like that. If when you make your trip to the grocery store, keep in mind persons in our community who go without and bring some canned goods and place them in the bins around our church, and we'll share them with some of the agencies with whom we work. I want to say a special word of thanks to our own homegrown brass ensemble today, young members of our church who have musical talent and who are willing and glad to share that with us. And they're listed on the back of the bulletin. Please take note of that. And from the age that you see, hopefully we'll have them among us for quite some time. But it's always heartening for those of us who've been around a while to see young people talented and wanting to share that talent for the glory of God. And so we're grateful for these young men and women. Today is also a new attempt to let young people be a part of the worship service, as we're employing a couple of acolytes this morning. And perhaps you noticed them bringing the light into the sanctuary, which is symbolic, of course, of the light of the world coming among us. And for that reason, we stand and sing and rejoice and worship. And so David Covington's been working not only with our musicians, but also as our He's our worship guru around here, and he's been working with our acolytes as well. But we appreciate their willingness to serve the church in this way. I hope you'll take note of the comments on the back of the bulletin with regard to the Hallelujah Chorus. When the choir often sings the Hallelujah Chorus, I know there are some of you out there who are frustrated, wishing that you could join in them and today with them, and today you can, a couple of different ways. On the bulletin insert this morning, this is the Hallelujah Chorus cliff notes. For those of us who don't read music, but simply want to follow along and do the best we can, this tells you to sing Hallelujah 10 times, and then this is perfect for people like me. For people like some of you who read music, at the end of each pew, there are supposed to be scores of the Handel's Messiah, and the Hallelujah Chorus is found on page 193. We tell you this because, as you see on the back of the bulletin, following the charge and benediction, it doesn't say a choral response to the benediction. It's the congregational response. And so if you are inclined, you're invited to join in with the choir as we together sing that glorious piece of music that we often sing during the highest holy days of the year. And so grateful that we have, whether we read music or not, have the opportunity to join our voices with the voices of the choir. The folks with the Adult Fellowship group have asked me to let you know there's still spots. If you'd like to join them on their trip to Snow Hill, North Carolina, for lunch at the Strickland Dale Restaurant for good food and good fellowship this Thursday, the 27th of March. If you'd like to go, just give us a call in the church office, or you can call Emmeline Walls or Glenn Rose directly. And that gives me an opportunity to say the church office will be closed tomorrow. Church offices are pretty busy places the week leading up to Easter, and so tomorrow will be a time for the church staff to catch their breath a little bit. But if you need us, we will be back around the office on Tuesday. But again, we're grateful that you are here with us today as we worship the risen Christ.
A Christian sympathy is extended to the family of Virginia Hunter, who died on Friday in the care facility in Georgia where she and Mitch had been living. That service will be Tuesday at Mitchell Funeral Home on Highway 70 West at 11 a.m. and visitation is at 10 on Tuesday. Virginia and Mitch had celebrated their 70th anniversary in February. Oscar Hay was taken to Rex on Friday with chest pains, but he was back home yesterday afternoon. Louise Cooper remains at Rex in the intensive care unit, and Melba Sparrow had stem cell transplant at UNC this past week. Let us look to God in a time of prayer. Great God, on this glorious Easter morning, we sing songs of praise and joy, for Christ has risen. We thank you that the stone has been rolled away and that the tomb is empty and that Christ reigns victorious. We thank you that through Christ we have forgiveness of sins and the promise of eternal life. We praise you for the hope that we have in him. May we share that good news with others that they might claim those promises for themselves. We pray especially today for a broken and hurting world, for places where there is war or violence, for persons who know hunger or lack pure water to drink or adequate housing. We pray for those who desperately need kindness and generosity. And we pray for those who need to hear words of love and to have an opportunity to learn and grow. We pray for the sick and the dying, the bereaved and the disillusioned. We pray for those whose hearts are broken and those whose hearts are frozen, those who are filled with anger and hatred. We pray for those who struggle with mental illness, addiction, or abuse. We pray that all persons, young and old alike, that they might know safety and security. We pray that all of us might renew our faith and commitment as we celebrate again Christ's victory. Open our eyes to your blessings, our hands to service, and our hearts to your guidance, that we might experience once again your call and will for our lives. Help us to be your faithful people at work in the world who pray together the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Prayer for illumination. Almighty God, we pray for our ears to be open and our minds clear so that our hearts may embrace the words of the Holy Scripture read here today. Amen. The Old Testament lesson comes from Jeremiah chapter 31. I'll begin with verse 7. Now hear the word of the Lord. For thus says the Lord, sing aloud with gladness for Jacob, and raise shouts for the chiefs of the nations. Proclaim, give praise, and say, save, O Lord, your people, the remnant of Israel. See, I am going to bring them from the land of the north, and gather them from the farthest parts of the earth, among them the blind and the lame, those with child, and those in labor together. A great company, they shall return here. With weeping they shall come, and with consolations I will lead them back. I will let them walk by brooks of water, in a straight path in which they shall not stumble. For I have become a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. Hear the words of the Lord, O nations, and declare it in the coastlands far away. Say, he who scattered Israel will gather him, and will keep him as a shepherd of flock. For the Lord has ransomed Jacob and has redeemed him from hands too strong for him. They shall come and sing aloud on the height of Zion, and they shall be radiant over the goodness of the Lord, over the grain, the wine, and the oil, and over the young of the flock and the herd. Their life shall become like a watered garden, and they shall never languish again. Then shall the young women rejoice and dance, and the young men and the old shall be merry. I will turn their mourning into joy. I will comfort them and give them gladness for sorrow. I will give the priests their fill of fatness, and my people shall be satisfied with my bounty, says the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We're going to do things a little out of order this morning. I'd like to invite the children to come join me up front. They've been sitting there a long time, and this will give them a chance to stretch their legs. And me too. Y'all scoot on in. That's fine. We got plenty of room. Good morning. Has anybody said Happy Easter to you yet today? Yes. Well, good. I just wanted to make sure, because if nobody has said it, I wanted to say it to you. So here goes. Happy Easter. Well, thank you. In just a few minutes, I'm going to read from the Bible. I'm going to read from the Gospel of Matthew, and you probably know that Matthew is somebody's name, right? Have you ever heard that name, Matthew?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Some of you might even know somebody named Matthew. But do you know that? Do you know what the word gospel means? You know somebody named Matthew. That's a good name. Last name. Does anybody know what the word gospel means? What? It is a book in the Bible. That's exactly right. Now, but the word gospel, does anybody know what that means? I could probably ask the grown-ups out there and they wouldn't know either. But it's a real simple, it's really simple, which means you're going to learn something today. The word gospel means, pay attention now, the word gospel means good news. That's all it means, good news. And so when you read the Gospel of Matthew, it's Matthew telling people what? Good news. Good news. Now, what was Matthew's good news about? What was the Gospel of Matthew and Mark and Luke and John? What did those people want to write good news about? Who was it about? It's about Jesus. It was good news about Jesus. And today, we think about the best good news about Jesus. If you know what this is, you know this is Easter Sunday. You might also know that Friday, which we call Good Friday, was the day that Jesus died. Did y'all know that? And Easter Sunday, why do we celebrate Easter Sunday? Because that doesn't sound so good because Jesus is dead, right? Why do we celebrate Easter? He was dead, and then what happened? He came back to life. What we say is that God raised Jesus from the dead. Now, had Jesus stayed dead, today would not be a happy day. It would just, because Saturday wouldn't have been happy and Sunday wouldn't have been happy, there wouldn't have been many happy days anymore. But because Jesus was brought back to life and because he still lives, we celebrate today. And so it's good news. It's gospel. One of the things that people in churches around the world, they do something kind of special today, and we've already done it this day, is someone says, Christ is risen, and the other people say, Christ is risen indeed, okay? And indeed just means it really happened, okay? So one person says, Christ is risen, and the other people say, Christ is risen indeed. So we're going to try that just with us this morning. I'm going to say, Christ is risen, and then I want you to say, Christ is risen indeed. Can you say that? And that will mean you're doing things that people in churches all over the world are doing today. Are you ready? Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
One more time. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
That's the good news we have to share with the world. It's gospel. Now, we don't have children's church today, so you're going to need to go out and find your parents. But first, let's pray. Let's bow our heads together and pray. Can you pray with me? Dear God, we thank you for good news. And for the special good news of Easter. Amen. Now, if you can go back and find where you were sitting. Thanks for coming to see me this morning. It's harder than it looks for a child to go back and find where they were sitting. Since they didn't leave breadcrumbs or anything like that. Hopefully they've all made their way. We turn now to the Gospel of Matthew, the good news according to Matthew, the 27th chapter and the 62nd verse, and our reading will go on into the 28th chapter. Listen again to God's word for us. The next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, "Sir, we remember what the impostor said while he was still alive. After 3 days, I will rise again. Therefore, command the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may go and steal him away and tell the people he has been raised from the dead. And the last deception would be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard of soldiers. Go, make it as secure as you can." So they went with the guard and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him.' This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. As a bit of a preface to the sermon today, the title for this sermon draws its inspiration from an obituary that I read more than a year ago. The obituary was for Art Buchwald, who was a humorist, a political satirist. I have felt a connection with Art Buchwald for a long time because he was the commencement speaker on the day I graduated from the College of William and Mary. I've got a couple of his books. And for some reason, I happened to be seeing in the Washington Post a little over a year ago, his obituary. And his obituary was entitled "Exit Laughing." The reason for that is that he was diagnosed with cancer and was moved into a hospice unit. But what surprised everyone is that he didn't die right away. He was surprised he didn't die right away. And so his first thought was, "Well, if I'm not going to die, I might as well write another book." And he did. And the book he wrote was true to himself. It was full of laughter and jokes and witticisms because it was his intention to exit laughing. Let us pray. Lord God of grace, pour out your Spirit upon us as we gather here this day, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts will be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. I don't know if you listen to the National Public Radio program known as Prairie Home Companion. It airs on Saturday evening, and then around here it airs again on Sunday afternoon. While I'm a fan of the show, I hardly ever get to listen to it, first because I'm rarely in the car when it's on, and secondly because I'm a product of the television generation, I have a hard time sitting in my living room listening to the radio. Actually, these days, I'm more likely to hear it on my iPod after I've downloaded the podcast from the internet. Those of you who grew up listening to the radio in your living room have no idea what I just said. But the Prairie Home Companion is a wonderful radio variety show starring Garrison Keillor and his cast of very talented sidekicks who do comedy sketches and short skits, and they welcome wonderful musical groups. And then the highlight on most weeks is when Garrison Keillor tells us a story of life in Lake Wobegon, a quiet Minnesota village located in the center of his imagination, a town made up of hard-working, good-hearted Lutherans, a town made up of people who seem familiar to us because they are us. And while Prairie Home Companion follows this format for most of its broadcast, they have an annual tradition which I love. It's the annual joke show, where for 2 hours they tell jokes, one joke after the other. They tell knock-knock jokes, light bulb jokes, they tell preacher jokes and lawyer jokes. All they do for 2 hours is tell jokes, some that make you laugh, some that make you groan, some you want to try to remember because you want to be the one to tell it the next day. It's a great show, 120 minutes devoted to adding much-needed laughter to the world. Now, the reason I tell you about that tradition is to tell you about another tradition that is similar to the annual joke show, but a tradition that seems odd at first hearing. It is the tradition among the Eastern Orthodox Church during the season of Easter to gather in the sanctuary, sometimes the day after Easter, sometimes the evening of Easter, sometimes even on Easter morning, to gather in the sanctuary to listen to the priest tell jokes. To gather in the sanctuary for the specific purpose of laughing, of telling jokes and laughing. Now, there isn't a more tradition-bound religion than the Eastern Orthodox. Worship among the Eastern Orthodox is led by heavily bearded priests in ornate vestments, in sanctuaries thick with incense, with heavily gilded ornamentation, with icons all around, with a highly elaborate liturgy that dates back thousands of years. The Eastern Orthodox are serious people. But at Easter, they laugh. They laugh. They gather together in their sanctuaries, their holy places, and they laugh. Which seems a bit odd, doesn't it? I mean, the Christian faith is serious business. Holy Week is about serious things, life and death things, but our Eastern Orthodox cousins can't contain their laughter at this time of the year. And perhaps you wonder why. Well, a couple of years ago, when we were taking Amy around to look at colleges, as we did with Randall a few years before, one of the things we had on our list to do is show them, and this will come as no surprise, is show them the College of William and Mary. As alums, Jenny and I at least wanted our children to see the campus and to take a look, and as you know, we struck out twice. But in our most recent visit there, one of the things they arranged for these prospective students was to hear a lecture by one of the professors on the faculty. And as we looked through the brochure, we saw that we were going to hear a lecture from a religion professor, which could have been deadly. But this religion professor's specialty was humor and how humor works, why humor works, how it functions, basically what makes us laugh. And my memory is that we laugh for mainly three reasons. One type of laughter emerges sort of as a sigh of relief when we dodge some danger and we realize we're not in trouble after all. We laugh as a release from our anxiety. Another reason we laugh is when we see someone do something ridiculous or a ridiculous thing happen to someone else. Now here, of course, context is important. For the same thing happened to us, we wouldn't think it quite so funny. This is why we can look at videos of terrible things happening to other people at their weddings, but we'd be horrified if those things happened at ours. With enough distance, we can laugh at calamity. The final reason we laugh, though, he said, is when we're surprised. This is why we laugh at most jokes. We don't see the punchline coming. When we were expecting to hear one thing and we hear something else, it surprises us, and so we laugh. We laugh because we're caught off guard. This, I think, is why the Eastern Orthodox Church laughs as they think about Easter. This is why they laugh as they consider the resurrection of Jesus. They laugh because no one saw this coming. When Rome crucified troublemakers as they did by the thousands, those troublemakers stayed dead. When a lifeless body was laid in a tomb and a large stone rolled to cover its place, that was that. End of story. But on the Sunday morning after the Friday afternoon, some women went to the tomb and they found it empty. And then they heard a message that didn't really compute. It didn't make sense to them nor to the people they told. Christ is risen. This did not compute because this is not how things are supposed to happen. They all watched Jesus die. And after an appropriate time of mourning and grief, they were planning to get back onto their normal lives, back to their fishing boats and their families. That's what people do after they've lost a loved one. They grieve for a while and then they get on with life. And so that's what Jesus' followers were expecting to do. But now they hear that Christ is risen, which means that there won't be any getting back to normal now because there's a new normal now. And 2,000 years later, the Eastern Orthodox Church is still laughing about it. And it's the sort of laughter, and maybe this makes sense to you, that comes when we're in on something, when we're in on the joke, when we're in on the practical joke, when we know ahead of time that something wonderful or hilarious or joyful is about to happen. It's the sort of laughter that comes when we know something that others don't. And part of the joy is anticipating the moment when they'll be let in on the secret too. A couple of years ago, I was down in South Carolina playing golf with three of my preacher friends, playing golf for three straight days on some beautiful courses. And on the first afternoon we were there, one of the other guys and I needed to go to a golf store, hoping to find something that would improve our game. And my friend needed some golf balls, and so he bought balls, and he was standing at the counter, and he noticed some other paraphernalia up there, and he noticed some golf novelty items, and the one that caught his eye was an exploding golf ball. Now, you may have seen one of these things. They look pretty much like a golf ball, but they're made of chalk or talc or some other powdery substance so that when you put it on a tee and hit it with your driver, it explodes in a cloud of dust. Well, for 3 days, he carried this golf ball around with him, just waiting for the right moment to use it. And late on the third day, he gave me a little look that let me know that this was it. And so with the other three of us standing behind on the back of the tee, we just stood there waiting for him to do what he always does, which is hit a shot right into the woods. And so as he swung with all of his might and made contact with the ball, it did what it was designed to do. It exploded. It exceeded our imagination. And these, my other two friends who weren't in on the joke, almost came out of their skin. But the one who knew about the joke, he and I got more joy out of it because we had 2 days of anticipation and then the joy of watching their surprise. The Eastern Orthodox Christians are on to something here when they realize that Easter is a time for joyous laughter. For they know that we have been let in on the biggest surprise the world has ever known. That while the rest of the world seems to be walking around under a pall of gloom and darkness, while there seems to be an air of despair saturating the air and choking the joy out of life, while there seems always to be this undercurrent of fear and anxiety and hostility that makes the human race live on edge, and while the dread of our own mortality seems always to be lurking out there, we have been let in on the marvelous bit of good news. Christ is risen. Yes, there's still a lot of darkness out there, but we know that light chases away the darkness and not the other way around. And yes, there is still tragedy and trauma out there, but we know that all of that is temporary because in the resurrection of Jesus, God has defeated the things that seek to defeat us. Which means, very simply, that laughter can come back into the world. You see, there wasn't much laughter in the world on that Friday night and all day Saturday, unless it was among those who crucified Jesus as they laughed at how easily they had squashed yet another would-be Messiah. But among the people who had been following Jesus for 3 years, Friday and Saturday were tough days. They were days of sadness and sorrow. Sunday, though, was different. Things looked different on Sunday. And laughter came back to the world on Sunday. And we're in on it. That's my point. We're in on the joke. We're a community rooted in the resurrection. Were it not for the resurrection, we'd be doing something else today. Were it not for the resurrection, we wouldn't be a community today. And unless I miss my guess, if it weren't for the resurrection, there would be a lot less laughter in the world today. For without the resurrection, we'd be living with the common assumption and the daily reminder that death wins. And in a world where death wins, there's not much to laugh about. But our very presence in the world is a reminder that death has not won. The very presence of this church on this street corner in this city is a reminder that God's power to bring forth life is stronger than death's power to take it away. Our very presence in the world is a testimony that even in a world of darkness and death, there is reason to hope and there is reason to laugh. Maybe you know about them. I've just learned about them. It's a group of aspiring actors. I think they're located in New York City, called Improv Everywhere. And what they do is they go unannounced into a crowded, bustling place, and at an appointed time, they launch into a performance. I've seen a couple of clips of their performances. They're really interesting. One begins at a food court at a shopping mall, just a typical food court, and all of a sudden a girl at a hamburger counter starts to sing. And then patrons start to stand up and sing and dance. The security guard comes over and begins to sing. The custodian stops sweeping the floor long enough to begin singing and dancing. All singing and dancing together in the midst of a bunch of patrons who have no idea what's going on. The even more fascinating performance, though, took place in Grand Central Station. And at the appointed time, these actors, as they moved along with the thousands of other people trying to get to their trains with places to go and people to see, at the appointed time, the members of this group just froze in their tracks. One bent over to tie a shoelace, another by the schedule looking at the trains, one frozen there reading a paper, one talking on a cell phone, others just stopped in mid-stride on their way through the station. And for a moment or two, they were just standing perfectly still. And at first, people just buzzed by them. They're busy. They've got places to go. But then people began to notice them and to wonder what they were doing. People began to take note and gather around and look at these odd people just standing here. Before long, the whole train station was brought to a halt, mesmerized by these people who were doing nothing but standing still. And then, as quickly as they stopped, they were off again. The show was over, and the crowd burst into applause. Not even certain of what they had witnessed, but they knew that it brought a spark of joy to a place where people think they're too busy for it. Well, when I saw those videos, it made me think of the church and our odd presence in the world, singing hymns of joy in a world of sadness and pain, and occasionally making a conscious decision not to go with the flow and wondering who notices. And it made me wonder and think that maybe that group ought to go to a museum or a grocery store or some such place and begin laughing as if they were in on something hysterical, to simply begin laughing to see if the people around them might begin laughing too. But then I thought, maybe that's what we should try. To exit laughing. Or if going out into the world laughing is just too out of character for a group of serious-minded Presbyterians, what if we simply went out into the world having heard the good news of the Easter message, and what if we were filled with such joy and peace and hope and contentment that even people who have known us for years would notice something different about us? Imagine that. If, having heard the good news of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, having been let in on the most remarkable bit of good news ever shared, what if we all left here with such joy in our hearts that people would actually stop and take note of us? Wondering what we knew. Wondering what we knew that was causing such joy to well up inside us. Imagine that. Presbyterians living with such uncontainable joy, with such peace, that people would notice. Imagine that. To God be the glory, now and forevermore. Amen. And now, God's people, let us stand and say what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Let us present unto God our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we ask your blessing on these offerings that we bring, that they may share the good news of Jesus Christ with others. Amen.
As you go out from this place, remember what you have heard today. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Allow the joy of that good news to sink into your life so that you might add to the world's love and light and laughter. And now may grace, mercy, and peace, the triune blessings of a triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and abide with you, with all those you love, and with God's people everywhere, now and forevermore.